And I was like, one for two, meh. But man, I tell you what, that card just it keeps going and going. It's like the Energizer Bunny. It just like it never stops. Once you put it into play, as long as you can keep building on it, it is just super powerful.
Yeah, it makes every play after it better, and it made every play before it better. So like, ugh.
It's just always going to be good. And then, you know, we have the other Anthem effect that we talk about, always watching, you know, just to go
Yeah,
in that
and they
deck as well.
just
So
again, it like the White Weenie deck and that they're trying to make in this format feels like it's just like a
it's like
boulder, and you just push it, and it just keeps going and going and going.
it's like kind of
Yeah,
like
Energizer Bunny.
if block was still a
Okay, too
thing,
many.
yeah. If block was still a thing, then this would
Yeah,
be
this
the kind
yeah,
of
this would be
the
the deck.
starting point to the
Sure.
block constructed.
All right, you got the next one, the sweet one here, Dave.
I do.
We've already talked about this one again, but
Declaration in Stone. I think my opinion has changed. Well, changed a
I
little bit on this.
guarantee mine has
Yeah,
changed.
I know Mike's has changed. So I was kind of high on this card to begin with, but Declaration in Stone. If you don't know what it is, it's a sorcery for colorless and a white. It's a rare. Exile target creature and all other creatures its controller controls with the same name as that creature. That player investigates for each non-token creature exiled this way. So, able to kill any creature. You can clear out tokens, you know, the multitude of tokens. They don't get a clue if you hit tokens, so that's kind of
You don't got a
sweet.
clue.
Yeah. And,
Ornithopters are dead.
yeah. And I think what I originally said is, you know, this is going to be at its best in an aggressive deck, and I still think that that's the case. You know, if you're pressuring them, they're not going to have as much time to kind of take a turn off or whatever to draw a card off of their clue.
Not gonna have
So,
enough time to figure things out.
yeah,
I
they're
just
going to
need
be
time to
scrambling. They're going to be
think.
scrambling.
It's like a dad in the car, just like raging. I gotta just shut up for a little bit. I need time to think, figure it out. No, I don't need to stop for directions.
But I think that it's somewhat comparable to Path to Exile in that, you know, you're removing their creature and giving them a resource. Yeah, you're not putting a land into play, but they're getting a clue. Yes, it does cost two mana instead of one, and it's a sorcery instead of an instant, but hey, this is what we got, man.
No,
It's not as good as Path.
no, you're right. I think this card is very good. I think having I was because I was fairly high on it too. I think Dave, you were definitely higher than me in the beginning. Having cast a spell a couple times, I'm definitely high on it. I think it could be modern playable in the right shell. Like the tokens aspect of it is really, really good, like disgustingly good. But yeah, just being able for two mana in standard right now, we've had such bad removal in general, just be like, anything I want is dead. You know, outside of, you know, an untapped Ojutai. And even then, they want to attack at some point. Let's be honest. All right. Yeah, it's very nice. And you don't really feel, because of the clue, you don't feel bad. You don't feel bad if you kill a Jace with it on turn two. And you definitely don't feel bad if you're killing like something else. Like it's not a feel bad sort of spell. So I don't know, I'm pretty high on the card. I think
Yeah.
it's very good.
It's definitely going to be like one of the best cards that comes out of the set. White seems to be getting very well rewarded in the set. Maybe to be punished in Eldritch Moon. Who knows?
Yeah, maybe there's some Blacks Rise again. Maybe it's like Torment 2.
Yeah. But yeah, this card you'll see it everywhere. This will be one of the cards that if you're planning on playing white, that you'll want to pick up your playset early, because it's definitely something you're going to be wanting to be packing week one.
I guess we can go through the next two pretty quickly here, Dave. Descend Upon the Sinful, we talked about.
Yep.
Remember, the French one is Descend Upon the Fisherman. Six mana, white, four colorless, exile all creatures. Delirium, you get to put a 4/4 angel into play. And this card lives or dies off the Delirium. Exiling all creatures, don't get me wrong, is very good, and there's certain decks where that's going to be even better against. You know, opponents who have, like, sat on, like, a couple large Hangarback Walkers because you're like, yeah, go ahead, play an Outburst. And you're like, no.
No, Avacyn and the angels are going to be coming for you.
But if you get that 4/4 angel, it can be pretty
Oh,
devastating.
it's so good. Yeah.
I mean, six
This
mana is still a ton, so you can't just be like jam four in your deck and just be like, let's roll.
Yeah.
But it's good.
I was not very high on this card when I first saw it, but man, that Delirium trigger is so powerful. I guess you have to play with this card or see it played before you really believe.
This is what you wanted Surge of Tentacles to be. Or Crush of Tentacles, I'm sorry. Because it has Surge.
But yeah.
This is what you wanted that card to be. We're like, I want to get an 8-8. No, you're like, no. You want to exile all creatures and get a 4-4 with flying. This is what you really wanted. This is the dream you want to live.
Right. I feel like a lot of times, like if you're playing a control deck with, you know, Planeswalkers, a lot of times if you tap out to Wrath the board, you're leaving yourself open to, you know, a haste creature attacking your Planeswalker or like a manland activation or something like that. Being able to have the 4-4 back as a blocker, you know, even on that first turn there is just so good. But, like, you're just coming out ahead. I mean, you're wiping the board and you're left with a 4-4, you know, which is pretty good win condition, you know, in most cases.
Yep. Perfectly acceptable.
It may end up getting bounced by a Reflector Mage sometimes, but that's fine. You know, it's, you got it for free, essentially. So, I like this card a lot, and I do think it'll be pretty important in the format as we go, and standard.
I like the flavor text, too. Above the cries of phrase ring out, you will all be saved. So I feel like you have to say this when you cast this card, like all the creatures, you will all be saved. Really?
Yeah. Totally. You won't feel any more pain anymore.
So sad sounding. Shh. It's okay, fisherman.
It's okay, fisherman.
And anyway. They're like, hey, that's net very nice.
Oh.
No? I'm sorry. I was bobbing up and down for a joke.
We have all been here for a very long time, and I can't think of anything punny to say back to you. So
fair enough.
I'm just going to look at you disapprovingly.
All right. Wipe that trout off your face. See, it was supposed to be pout and trout. I don't know. Please read the next card, Dave.
We're getting to that wacky point in the palooza that we always hit after like the 3-hour mark.
Yeah, I bet. It would all be right. Great.
Okay, next card. Eerie Interlude. We talked about this when it was first spoiled. It was in the dual deck?
Yes.
Yep.
So this is basically Ghost Away, but you get to choose which cards stay. So it's 2-colorless white instant, exile any number of target creatures you control, return those cards to the battlefield under their owner's control at the beginning of the next end step. So if you have a lot of comes into play triggers, it's a way to kind of get a second use out of those. You can save your creatures from cards such as, I don't know, Descend Upon the Sinful. So it's pretty cool. I don't know that I'll actually see any standard play. Ghost Way, I don't think, was played in standard originally. But
it's got modern play, though.
It's seen some fringe modern play.
It has. I think we already have a couple compelling cards with Enter the Battlefield triggers. You know, Reflector Mage being the major one. So it wouldn't take much for, I think, this card to see play.
So, like, if you are really worried about Wraths in your mono-white weenie deck, you could play this. It interacts pretty well with what Volley's is in it, right? They'll come back into play and you just have a bunch of triggers because you're humans.
That's pretty cool.
That's fine. That's fine. Yeah, sure.
I will say, like, traditionally, cards like this don't really pan out as, like, Wrath protection. Like, that's kind of, like, where everybody goes when they first see it. They're like, oh, man, it's sweet. You can just, like, basically, like, counterspell a Wrath. But it never really plays out that way in practice. Like, there's been a ton of cards over the years that have been like this. Like, the Collar of the Claw was, like, the green one. You know, it's...
I don't know if you want to call it, because, like, we have Vile Redeemer in Standard, too. I don't know if they're similar, but...
Yeah, like, well,
Yeah, but people could still try.
You could try.
Don't do that, man. Don't let them try.
Yeah.
Don't take their hope.
You're going to be the one casting the Wraths anyway, so who cares?
You're a father.
I'm excited about... I'm excited about that Thalia's Lieutenant...
we got it.
Yeah,
the one that Morgan said.
Yeah. I was saying, like, I'm excited about that interaction. I didn't think about that.
Yeah, it's sweet.
So, there you go.
All right, let's go to Puncturing Light. Is that the last white card?
Yes, I believe so.
All right. So this is a colorless and a white for an instant. Destroy target attacking or blocking creature with power 3 or less. Pretty simple, but you know, I literally cast a Reeve Soul on camera the first week of battle format. So cards like this are definitely playable. We also saw what Last Breath saw a lot of play. When it was legal, different, but it's in the same vein of like conditional removal that kills a small subset of creatures. I don't know how much play this sees with Surge of Righteousness still in the format. However, if the mono white deck is the aggro deck to beat, then Surge of Righteousness doesn't do much against that deck. So,
I think, like, as long as we have Silk Wrap still in the format and we still have Stasis Snare and things like that. Like, Wei has so many removal spells, it's ridiculous. I think, like, this one I'll actually probably not end up seeing too much play, at least at the moment, you know, the way the format is. Like,
sure.
Possibly after the next rotation, maybe.
But like this one has Bruno on it.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet art.
Yeah, it's definitely like 80s hair metal Bruno, too. Like, yeah, I would buy that album, probably.
It was a great Iron Maiden album.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
So what do we think of White, then?
Best color in the
set. Yeah, oh, yeah, by far.
By far, yeah. Just, like, by virtue of Archangel Avacyn and Declaration in Stone, I think that puts the... That puts it head and shoulders above the others. So
yeah, it's definitely like got so much constructed power in it. Like white is like the color I think a lot of people are going to gravitate towards initially, and especially since you still have a bunch of, you know, supporting characters in white that'll still be very, very good. Your Gideons, your don't want to sound like a broken record here, but your Reflector Mage. Your Ojitai's, those are going to be great cards still. And it doesn't seem like they're going to get any worse by the cards coming into the format.
Yep. And, we mentioned all the human interactions,
and that
synergies
that helps bring back a deck that a lot of people would really like to play that has not been viable. So hopefully that is the thing because people like to play their white weenie cards.
Yeah, there are a ton of really powerful cards in white here. So seems like they're really trying to ramp that up because I feel like white's kind of been pretty poor like for a while.
Yeah,
it's been getting better.
All right,
we'll see.
We're in Yeah, no, you can say it. That's fine.
I was going to say the home stretch too.
I understand that.
Hey, yeah, we do have a lot of horses in this set too, for some reason. So
yeah, they're like a bunch of black horses. Yeah. Like, I just want to point out, I mentioned this. There is definitely a black horse. It's like a ghost horse, and it's stuck in a swamp. That is definitely Artax. And Wizards, I have a problem with you making an Artax card because that is the single most depressing. If you ever saw just saw the Neverending Story. The first movie.
Ghoulsteed, is that what you're talking about?
The Ghouls, is that the 4-4?
Yeah.
It's the other one, I think.
Oh, the other one.
Yeah.
We have multiple horses for some reason.
Three black horses, actually, if not I think about it.
They must have really been influenced by the Katy Perry song.
You're right. But yeah,
Stallion of Ashmath?
Yeah, is it the one where it's like in a swamp? No, Stallion of
Ashmath. It's a nightmare horse.
Yeah, Stallion of Ashmath, the one that has the delirium trigger, right?
Yes.
Come on, Dave. You've got to find this horse for me.
Anyway, there's a horse.
It is Ghoulsteed.
It's a horse.
I'm sorry,
of course,
it is Ghoulsteed. It is Ghoulsteed because it has like arrows coming out of it. Artax was a horse who was with Atreyu, and they went through the bog of eternal sadness, and his horse got sad. And when you get sad, the bog sucks you in, and his horse died of depression right in front of him. This wasn't a joke. Like,
get sucked into the bog.
Atreyu was like, no, come on. Like, was like super sad. And if you watch that, well, go watch it now as an adult. It's awful. Like, the horse just is too depressed to keep moving. If a horse can get that depressed, why are we even trying?
Well, I mean, this
hashtag
one has like
nihilist wizards.
This one has like some arrows sticking out of its back, so maybe it doesn't.
No, it just didn't move. Okay. It just didn't move.
It was an easy target.
Let's finish it. Let's go on to lands. I'm sorry. That was a quick aside, but it was really upsetting to me, actually.
Is it mine?
I
guess we can all just talk about the Shadowlands.
I mean, yeah, we already discussed them a little bit. I think we've all seen them in action a little bit. Morgan and I have gotten to play around with them a little bit. I think they're exactly what we expected.
Yeah, they're fine. They're a bit awkward. Frank Carson just wrote his mana article about them, so if you want to learn more...
Yeah,
and I really like dense articles. Check it out.
Yeah, there's a lot of information to unpack, but it's good information. Carson
for
is
sure.
The
best. We appreciate it, even if we can't always understand it. But yeah, they're lands. They're standard lands, and they fix mana. Congratulations.
Yeah. I mean, these are only going to be playable in standard. I don't see them being played in any other format.
Nah.
So, It's better than nothing because we didn't know if we were going to be getting lands about a week ago. So that's fine.
We've also already talked about Draenor Temple. that card seems like it will be pretty good.
I don't know. Like, it's pretty cool, and, like, it does, you know.
I'm glad it exists, does, I guess. It does stuff. Is more than what I want to say.
It may not light Standard on fire, but I do think that, like, it's the kind of card that, like, in a couple years, it'll randomly be, like, pretty expensive, and, like, it will see a ton of play in Eternal formats, so.
I do appreciate that you can, like, play a Jace on turn 2, loot it away, and then, like, play it on turn three. You know, put it into play on turn 3.
Oh, yeah.
This is, like, kind of cool. You look at the flavor text, that this is it, all the cryptoliths point here, and it's just like, it's like Jace, like, I wonder if all these cryptoliths in a circle is a clue. Like,
is that pointing to something?
Huh.
Well, they're surrounding something that it seems to be lit.
I do want to mention, then, Westfall Abbey before we move on to lands.
Yeah.
And Westfall Abbey, I think, is really, really sweet. So it's just colorless land, taps for colorless. You may then pay 5, tap it, pay 1 life, and put a 1/1 black-white human cleric token onto the battlefield.
Doesn't sound very good, Mike.
I mean, Sliver Hive was playable in that was make a creature. So, that's right, it's under double-faced cards. I was trying to make sure I had the exact... Wizards.
We'll get you.
And then it has a second ability, which is pay 5, tap it, sacrifice 5 creatures, transform it. And when we flip it over, it becomes Ormondal, Profane Prince. It also gets untapped when you transform it.
Very important.
Which is a 9/7 legendary creature demon with flying, lifelink, indestructible, and haste. And, like, I sort of immediately latched onto this card. I was like, man, this card is sweet. And then the last couple of days here, it's sort of gotten, like, people are like, wait a second. This card does some things. Because the fact that it doesn't come to play tapped or do anything else, like, anytime you play a colorless horse, you could just play Westfall Abbey. And there's a number of decks that just, like, this slots perfectly into. And sometimes they have 5 creatures. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes you just play regular Magic with your land. But sometimes you attack for 9, and your opponent dies.
Yeah. This is a card that I really believe you'll have to have an answer for in your deck. Like, it can fit into a, not just, like, it can just fit into a lot of different archetypes. And it you don't even necessarily have to be playing a lot of creatures for it to be good. I mean, this land obviously creates its own creatures. It is slow to do so. But, man, this card is good. If you aren't prepared to deal with it in some facet in your deck, then you better be hoping that you can kill your opponents before this becomes a thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think you said it. I mean, it's really, there's very little cost to putting this in your deck. Like I said, it doesn't come into play tapped or anything like that. So, I mean, if you're playing a monocolor deck or even, you know, just 2 colors, I think it's very easy to just, like, slot at least one of these in. Like, it's almost free. Unless you have a lot of heavy mana requirements. You know, if you're playing, like, mono black with Relentless Dead or something like that. There's almost no reason not to play at least one of these.
Right.
Not to mention, like, if you're playing, like, any of the, you know, Eldrazi spells that require colorless mana, it's, like, probably the best utility land you could play, you know, as far as that adds colorless. So
yeah,
I mean, super, super good. You know, even if it eventually gets Reflector Mage, you can get one hit in with the 9/7 lifelink, which a lot of times can just swing the game for you. So
It's important to note that a lot of the white removal does hit it. It can get silk wrapped, hilariously enough.
It can get silk wrapped. It can get Declaration in Stone. It can get Reflector Maged. Any bounce.
Any bounce is pretty good against it.
So it's no longer a land on the backside. So anything that, you know, says, you know, destroy a non-land or whatever can hit this.
Yeah, Anguished and Making hits it. No longer
land. Yep.
It also can get, like, Eldrazi Displacer, which is pretty hilarious.
Oh, yeah. I'm just going to tap your land. You're done. Definitely be prepared for it. Let's move on to the multicolor card. Now, speaking of Anguish Unmaking, we already have talked about this card. This came out a little bit earlier within the season. Where did we land on it after seeing everything in the format?
I think it's fine. I think it'll be a fine role player. I was probably a little bit more excited when I first saw it, but now it's just, I don't know. It's better than Utter End. And I think, you know, unlike Utter End, I think this could see play in older formats, you know, possibly Modern, maybe even Legacy.
I mean, Vindicate, granted it's a sorcery, but still pretty good.
Well, in yeah, Legacy. This being able to exile maybe
Vindicate important. It's lands though.
No, I understand Vindicate's better than this card, but I'm Sorin's saying there may both. Be some corner cases.
That's the cool thing. Sorin is on the art for both.
Yeah, he is definitely.
That depends on which version of Vindicate. Foil, yeah. Yeah.
All right, we already talked about Arlen Court as well.
Hold on, we're not talking about Fevered Visions.
We didn't get there yet. Man.
I hate these stupid flip cards. I'm done with this.
Yeah,
we did talk about Arlen Court. How has your opinion changed on that one, Morgan?
It's kind of slowed down.
Oh,
if there's not a good, I don't think there's a good red green deck. In all honesty,
you didn't pre-order it for $40.
Oh God, no! I'm not a dumb dumb.
How are you gonna help me?
Sorry for anyone that did pre-order the card for $40. I totally just called you a dumb dumb. I'm so sorry. It's very late at night. Please don't hate me.
That's unreal, actually. maybe the card, I think, has a chance to be very good, right?
Yeah.
But, the format doesn't seem to support it.
I just, you said that, between all your testing, most of the time, it just dies.
Yeah, it doesn't get to bolt most of the time. It made a cool wolf, though.
That wolf's a pretty cool wolf. But is he 2-2?
He's a lone wolf, you might say.
Yeah, because
Arlen Court dies.
Because Arlen Court peaced out. Here's a wolf. I'm gone.
So I want Arlen Court to be good. It excites me still very much so as a Magic player. But the cards just aren't there to support it.
You gotta make a deck for it.
You could just play Deathless Raptor, Dent Protector, Arlen Court, and stuff.
Yeah.
But I don't know if it's good enough.
I just think that you don't have the. You don't have good red removal, right?
No, like, Roast is in such an awkward position. There's going to be so many cards it's great against, and there's going to be a lot of things it can't touch. And then you want to play Tears of Alakut, but then it can't hit anything on the ground. So then you want to play Lightning Axe, but you're not playing a deck that can take advantage of Madness.
No, you're not.
So then you're in a really bad position.
Yeah. So, like, man, Fiery Temper is great, but sometimes you just need Lightning Strike. Like, so that's just what you need.
No, for sure.
And we don't have it. And this card would really benefit from it.
Yeah, I think Michael Majors had a really good point today in his article where he said, this card is obviously very powerful on the surface. It does a lot of things. However, red and green as a color combination just may not be the best because it really doesn't have a good answer to Archangel Avacyn, which is probably going to be also just a format staple. Yeah. Right. So...
I would also point out that if Lightning Strike was in the format, Arlen Court would be almost unplayable as it is.
Oh, I guess that's true, too. Well, I don't know, then. You just need better removal
Can you imagine if somebody has Draconic Roar against you? They're just like, oh, kill your wolf and your Planeswalker.
Yeah.
Cool. Nice turn, bro.
But yeah, I'm with you, Mike. I really like this card, and I think it's really cool. I just don't know...
Can I play it in cube? I would love to play this card in cube.
Oh, man. So sweet.
Yeah.
Red and green have, a lot of good cards.
You can draft this card. You can play in your sealed deck, for sure. And so the only spot, the only space where this could even be a thing is potentially, a tokens deck. If there is a, a Tarkas Command, Nissa.
No, her plus one on the backside is still powerful enough with the Tarkas Command. Yeah, you're right. It could be.
But that is...
Still very weak to flyers.
Yeah.
Very weak to mass removal.
You just don't have the great token creators that you losing out on Hoarding Outburst is so huge.
Hey, you have Dragon Fodder.
You still have Dragon Fodder, that is very, very true. But man, the rate that you got from Hoarding Outburst was so good. So maybe we'll get something that creates tokens more efficiently, in red or green, or maybe Eldritch Moon really, gives us something that, pushes red green as an archetype as a whole, but until then I'm not super impressed with this card.
Alright, cool. Let's move on to Fevered Visions. A enchantment for a blue or red and a colorless. At the beginning of each player's end step, the player draws a card. So it's like a nice Howling Mine effect. Mm-hmm. If the player is your opponent and has four or more cards in hand, Fever Vision deals 2 damage to him or her. So I think we all sort of disregarded this card when we first saw it, but it is a pretty nifty little engine. I've played against this, and I was surprised too. It's one of the reasons I was like, hey, we're going to add this card to the list, and Dave was already on it. But I played against it a couple times, and it was surprising how difficult, depending on how your deck is set up, sometimes to get under 4 cards and stay there. And if they ever have 2 of them out, it's really difficult to stay below 4 cards consistently and not take 4 damage. Now... That being said, before you think that this is an amazing engine that's just perfect, you do make your opponent draw cards, a lot of them. And I definitely encountered some people who were really salty when I continued to draw gas. And I like was like, well, you do recognize that like your engine also supplies your opponent with plenty of like removal, right? Or gas or anything else that you're worried about. So I think this card is interesting. I would like to see how this card is built around. Dave, you mentioned it in conjunction with like maybe Sphinx's Tutelage, though I do think that you can only play so many do-nothing enchantments in your deck.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I don't know if that's a thing, but it's just a way to, you know, consistently trigger that, you know, a second time. It's really, this card reminds me, I don't know if you remember this deck. This is like from when the original Ravnica came out. There was a deck called Owling Mine.
Oh, yeah, I remember Owling Mine.
It's like a red-blue.
I wasn't even playing the game at the time, but I was told about it multiple times.
Yeah, so it was a red-blue deck that played like a lot of like Howling Mine effects and like card like Boomerang, like bounce effects like that. So it would basically just try to keep the opponent off balance enough, and then it would kill with Ebony Owl Netsuki, or Netsuke, which was just an artifact that dealt them damage if they had seven or more cards in their hand. So this kind of like does both the Howling Mind and the, you know, damage thing at the same time. I don't know if we have enough tools right now in Standard to make that kind of thing work, though. What was that blue card?
Engulf
the Shore. Yeah, that might be well like a card.
It. And Chandra does too, to be quite honest.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know. Like, it's a very interesting card. And you're right, I kind of glazed over it at first, but I kind of looked at it again. I was like, I don't know. That might be a thing. Like, that might be a sleeper.
Fair enough.
All right. Oh, I got the cool one. All right.
We've already talked about this card too, right?
Talk about it last week. I'm sorry, buddy. I know you weren't here. Man. If you want to say it, go ahead.
I listened. I did listen last week.
I'm glad you did.
I drove for 10 hours, man. I had a lot of podcasts queued up. Yeah, it was good. The Gitrog monster. Is that what people are calling it? Or Gitrog monster?
The Gitwrecked monster.
Gitwrecked monster. So this one is...
I think it's actually the Monster Energy drink.
He's got an arm hanging out of his mouth, man.
Yeah, he's eating things, man.
All right. So the Gitrog monster. Three colorless black green legendary creature, frog horror. It's a mythic rare. 6/6, death touch. At the beginning of your upkeep, sacrifice the Gitrog monster unless you sack a land. You may play an additional land on each of your turns. And it also has whenever one or more land cards are put into your graveyard from anywhere, draw a card. So, a lot of stuff going on with this card. It's got a lot of text. I think it's a good card in a vacuum. I don't think it'll end up being good in Standard. Though, I could see it being some kind of combo enabler in older formats, possibly.
Yeah, when we had Min on last week, he talked about how it creates an infinite dredge loop with Dakmor Salvage.
Yeah.
Because it's because Dakmor Salvage, like you can then, when you go to, or was it, you dredge it or whatever, I don't remember. I don't remember how he explained it. I don't care anymore.
So whenever you put Dakmor Salvage into your graveyard, you get a draw trigger. Well, you can dredge.
So if you have a way to discard, like...
Yeah.
So if you have a... I don't know.
So...
Zombie infestation.
Cool, yeah, okay. What do we think about this card for Standard?
I still don't know why it has Death Touch, but it's definitely in colors that people like. It's in colors that want Delirium, so you want a way to put lands in your graveyard. This card does cool things with things like Evolving Wilds.
Yeah.
So I definitely think there's ways to make this card exploitable. It's also a 5-mana 6/6, which there's not a lot of things that kill in the format. Outside of this white removal that just kills everything. You know, Stasis Snare and Declaration of Stone.
Mm-hmm.
Roast doesn't hit it. Ultimate Price doesn't hit it. So there's a lot of misses on that card. So if you can't find the right removal spell quickly when your opponent hits this card, they're going to overwhelm you in card advantage. So I think it could be good. I don't know if dominating or format warping, I don't want to go anywhere close to that amount, but I do think it's probably better than you might be giving credit for, Dave.
Possibly. Again, I wouldn't be surprised if it ended up being good. I just think that the way that I see the format shaping up, I think there's going to be a lot of Reflector Mage, and that's pretty good against this card. I think there's going to be a lot of Declaration in Stone, which is good against this. And again, I mean, dice removal is kind of a dumb argument, but I think those cards are going to be seeing a lot of play. So, We'll see. I mean, I think it's a really cool card, and I like it. I just, it's, I feel like if it had Trample, yeah, it'd be a lot better. And, like, it doesn't have a come into play effect.
Really, you know, for sure, and it gets Reflector Maged, and that's sad.
Right, so that's where I'm at.
Yeah, I agree with you on that, but I still will never understand why it's 6-6 has Death Touch, but whatever. Nahiri, we talked about Nahiri a lot. I think after looking at the format, I do think Nahiri gets better by virtue of just how good white is.
Yeah, that's true.
And white-red as a color combination, while traditionally not the most powerful, I would argue that it's been pretty good. but at the same time, I do think that like white is very powerful. You do get a creature land in those colors, and there's a lot you can do with it. So I still don't think Nahiri is any sort of like disgustingly good planeswalker, but there's a lot of value you can gain from her, and I think her color combination may end up being good.
I think it's the, you know, quote unquote worst planeswalker. However, it does have some utility. The ultimate's kind of weird.
Unless you're putting Emrakul on the plan.
Right, yeah. Like, if you get Emrakul, then it's pretty sweet.
I mean, I hear she's good at attracting Emrakul. I mean, I'm just saying.
But can I just ask you this? So how much would you have liked to have this when you played Big Boros, when that was in Standard? Would you have played this card?
Let me think about that format. Definitely would not have played it. Because Chandra Pyromaster is just strictly better than this card, I think.
Oh, you could play this too.
No.
You can kill.
I was trying to think about
exile.
Detention Sphere was something you could exile back then.
You could kill Underworld Connections.
Yep, that would be that. Sweet. But I think I think Chandra was just better.
Okay.
Chandra, was a legitimate card advantage. Obviously, didn't go to your hand, but you always netted a card off the top of your library. Whereas this was kind of selection.
Right.
So, and her, like, this ultimate, like, can win the game if you build your deck correctly, but Chandra's ultimate definitely won the game.
You can get a Stormbreath Dragon with it. You can still have all your mana on tap, so you can
monstrous it and then get it returned to your hand.
Yeah, and then you can do it again.
All right, let's continue.
You just have infinite mana, so it's
fine. Dave, talk about Olivia.
Modern Warfare.
There we go.
Colorless black red legendary creature vampire knight 3/3 flying. Whenever another creature enters the battlefield under your control, you may discard a card. If you do, put a +1/+1 counter on that creature. It gains haste until end of turn, and it becomes a vampire in addition to its other types. So I feel like we had a pretty good discussion on this a couple weeks ago.
I'm ready to make a pretty shocking statement about this card.
Yeah. I mean, this is a card. You can do your shocking statement, and then I'll talk about it.
That's fine. I did interrupt you, so it's fine. Go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. I do think this is a card that, you know, like, this is one of the payoffs for playing Black Red Vampires. It's aggressively costed. It fits the theme of the deck. And that, you know, it's aggressive. It lets you discard cards for madness. It kind of does everything you want.
It's not good in the Vampires deck. There you go.
And I actually believe that because I've seen it in action. It just wasn't that impressive to me.
You think it's doing everything you want? The argument's already been made that it's probably better with creatures that are just bigger than it. Like, curve this into your Thunderbreak region.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Then we got a stew going. But until then, you know, I don't know. The 3/3 for 3 that does nothing, like when it comes to the battlefield, as in this curve, this aggressive deck, doesn't feel very good. So, there you go. Shocking statement. Bold claim.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think it's that bold. I think it's easy to look at this card and be like, wow, this card is sweet. But I mean, how many cards have we seen in the past where, like, they always look good on paper, but the format lines up, it just doesn't really work out.
I agree with you on that. But I think it's certainly playable. And I just think it's not playable in the deck that people thought it was. So.
Yeah.
Talk quickly about Prized Amalgam. Can we just mention, as we look at Prized Amalgam, which is a blue and a black and a colorless for a creature zombie, 3/3. Whenever a creature enters the battlefield, if it enters from your graveyard or you cast it from your graveyard, return Prized Amalgam from your graveyard to the battlefield tapped, beginning of the next end step. Can we just talk about how awesome this love affair between, like, Ludovic and Stitcher Giralf is? There's so many flavor texts on these cards where, like, Giralf sends Ludovic a letter and he's like, hey, I'd love to, like, work with you on something. And then he goes to Ludovic's, like, like laboratory, and they're like best buddies. Like, I hope we get some sort of payoff card, like a P and Kieran Alar style. So like Ludwig and Giraffe, and like I want Ludwig to be holding Giraffe like in the same way, like over a balcony, and you get two zombie tokens when you cast it. Like, can we just get this, please?
Yeah, that card would be great. Just like blue black two.
And like you know, yeah, blue black two, yeah. And Giselle is like really sad because like she didn't realize that like they loved each other, and she's like, I wanted to be friends with you guys, and they're like, no, you could have been nice before.
Can you make zombies? I don't think so.
She does make zombies, actually. But she is more of a necromancer, whereas he's a Stitcher. Anyways,
like so zombies. He's a Frankenstein.
Yeah, she's a Liliana.
Yeah,
gotcha. I thought you were gonna point out the fact that this guy has like an Iron Man thing in his chest.
He's got like a power core.
Yeah. It's pretty sweet. He doesn't fly though, so I don't know.
I don't know. Have you seen it? No, this card is fine. A 3/3 for 3 is, again, not the most exciting thing in the world. However, if you're doing some shenanigans where you're getting a lot of these guys into your yard and then you're bringing things back, one of the decks I've seen playing this is a version of the blue-black Aristocrats deck that, I'm going to forget his name again. I had it top of my head. Heavy set magic.
Christian Calcano.
That's it. I always wears a hat. Christian Calcano played at the Pro Tour two Pro Tours ago.
Yeah.
Like people were playing that deck again with this card, and like so you like you flip your Liliana, you tick it up, you discard Prized Amalgam, and then like you minus Liliana, bring something back, and then your Prized Amalgam comes back, and it's got some cool like synergy in those shells. So because like you can cast it and then sack it to your Nantuka Husk, so you can get something back again. So I think it's definitely it's so synergistic, but I don't know if that deck is fully there yet. Again, another deck that feels like maybe it's missing something still.
Yeah. I think that the key with this is that, you know, like I said, 3/3 for 3 is not too exciting. However, being able to bring it back, it doesn't cost you anything. Like, you don't have to pay mana or discard a card or do anything. It just happens. So even with a card like Relentless Dead, which is just a sweet card anyway, you're like, oh, okay, these guys are best buds, just like, you know, Giralf and Ludovic.
Yeah, oh yeah. So I agree with that. So again, it feels like there's pieces of this blue black zombie deck. It's not quite there. We'll see what happens with it. Two more cards.
Three more cards. Two more multi.
God,
cards.
That terrible card. All right, yeah, whatever.
I feel like we just have to say something.
It's fine.
We got to warn the people.
Yeah, that's fair.
We got to let them know. All right, we're getting there though. All right, so Sigarda, Heron's Grace was another card we previously talked about. 3 green white legendary creature angel, 4/5 flying. You and humans you control have hexproof. Has 2 exile a card from your graveyard. Put a 1/1 white human soldier creature token onto the battlefield. Now that I've seen the whole set and kind of see what the format's kind of going to look like, I don't think this card will be playable. However, it's kind of sweet.
I think it's certainly playable, but because it shares a color with Avacyn, you're going to have to sell me on a real good reason why you're playing this instead of Avacyn.
Yeah, now, like,
if you're playing a bunch of little guys, like this one makes humans, maybe you don't want your Avacyn flipping and killing your board. Right. Maybe that's it.
You know, maybe you want to make humans for your Thaw-Use Lieutenant.
Tell me more.
So, like, this is your Curvetopper in a green-white humans deck, if there is such a thing. But so far, I haven't necessarily seen a huge compulsion to want to splash green. I think most of the white weenie decks would want to go towards blue.
And I hate to tell you this, and it's going to sound awful. I think in that deck, if you go white-green, Collect Company is a trap. Like, Collect Company hitting Thraben, like, Investigator or whatever it was, the 1/2. Like, that card's good as a 1-drop. It's not good if you hit 2 of them off a Collect Company.
Nah.
Just saying. So, Sigarda isn't in a weird place. She might get better depending on where the format goes, but she does seem sort of like a, odd angel out.
Yeah, I mean, she's not evil, so that definitely,
Angel in the outfield. Sorry, I had to say.
Anyway. All right. Let's move on to Sorin.
Sorin, another metal album cover.
Yeah, man. Jeez. I would buy the double pack that is the Bruna Sorin metal double pack.
Double CD.
Bruna that you find in like the bargain bin at Odd Lots or something like that.
You know that like their names are like everyone's singing those albums like really like deeply European. It's like Bruna and Soren.
It's got like an umlaut over the U in Bruna and over the O in Soren.
Absolutely.
No, it's the O with a strike through it, right? That's actually what the Soren one is.
We talked about
a Soren. Listener, please create those.
I'll make that. Come on.
Soren Grim Nemesis, blue and a, or blue.
Blue. That's blue.
Sorry. A white and a black and four colorless for a planeswalker that has six loyalty. Plus one, reveal the top card of your library and put that card in your hand. Each opponent loses life equal to its converted mana cost. Minus X, Soren Grim Nemesis deals X damage to a creature or planeswalker and you gain X life. And then minus nine, put a number of 1/1 black vampire knight creature tokens with lifelink onto the battlefield, equal to the highest life total among all players. Soren is definitely very powerful, has a ton of loyalty. I don't know what its place in this format is. You know, as a 6-mana planeswalker, it's not nearly as good as something like Elswith was, and it's not nearly as good as Chandra.
It's not good as Chandra, man. Chandra's so good.
And this card is not, at least my experience so far, is not stabilizing the board like people are hoping. You know, there's not enough decks that are just like one threat. So, and especially with like man lands too, like you kill their one threat and they're just like, all right, well,
I got this man land here.
You know, my Lumbering Falls kills it. That's cool. And like you gain some life and that's fine. But people are like, oh no, this is a great finisher. And then they want to play like three of them. And don't do that.
No.
Like Soren deserves like a 1 or 2 of slot depending on the build of the deck. But Soren's not your savior. He's your grim nemesis.
I
finished that. I dropped the mic right there. We're done.
Anyway.
Okay, go ahead.
I think, like, comparing it to Chandra isn't really fair because, I mean, they're in different colors. It's not like they're always going to be competing. Red. Okay, but this one is partly white, what I think is a pretty big thing going for it. And I do believe that, you know, black-white mid-range is going to be a thing in the new format. You know, we've seen it already prior to the rotation, and sure. I think it's, you know, it retains a lot of cards, you know, after rotation, and it gains, you know, it actually does gain a lot. So I think it could be a good, you know, curve topper for that style of deck. Doesn't really fit in an aggressive shell, and maybe in control, but I think in control deck it would have the issue that you said about how, like, you know, you might put it down, kill something, and then it's just going to die, which I don't know if that's really worth the investment of 6 mana, but certainly all the abilities are pretty powerful. Ultimate's like pretty awesome. You know, even if you ultimate it at, you know, kind of a single digit life total, it can still pull you out of that since the tokens have lifelink. So I think this is it's a pretty good card. I think it'll have, you know, pretty decent impact on the format.
Can I open it into a giant?
Yeah.
Because I want to.
Is that good?
Yeah, I want to deal X. I want to deal X damage to what with a card revealed the card's converted mana cost to both my opponents. Oh, thank you. Oh, please.
You'll only flip lands.
Oh. That would be sad. All right. But you could have not take any damage, and then you get like what 20? Was it 25 for two of a giant or 30?
30.
You get 30. I want to get 30/1/1 vampire knight lifelinkers. I mean, why not? Dream big, man. Dream big.
I thought you just said lint lickers.
Life linkers.
I got 30 lint lickers.
I'm not a Orbitz commercial over here. Or an Orbit. I guess it's just Orbit.
It's just Orbit, yeah.
I'm not an Orbit commercial. Anyway, last card. It's a bad one. Don't play this card. What card is it?
Corrupted Graphstone. It's a artifact. Cost 2. Enters the battlefield tapped, and it has the ability of tap, choose a color of a card in your graveyard, add 1 mana of that color to your mana pool. This is how far we've fallen.
Yeah, bad card's bad. Don't play this card. Even with the, like, what, Traverse the Uvenvald, like, even with that, nope, sorry.
Yeah, I mean, this is what we got for Mana Rocks now, people. We don't have Signets anymore. Those days are long gone.
They were too good.
So the problem with this card, if you were thinking about playing it, is that so Mana Rocks, you want to use them to accelerate you, obviously. So ideally, you'd want to, you know, play it on turn 2 to ramp you into a 4-drop. Well, this doesn't actually do anything unless you have something in your graveyard.
Correct.
And you can't even use something like, you know, an Evolving Wild. That doesn't work.
Nope. You can't. Fun fact: you can't use Ruin in their wake. Nope, doesn't work. No. Ruin the Wake is a colorless card.
Oh, God.
Oh, did so you bad. Not realize
no,
that?
No, I just hadn't cared enough, and now it's even worse than I originally thought, and I thought it was terrible already. So.
So no Eldrazi will help you with this?
Yeah. So, on top of all that, if you're playing a multicolor deck, like, you know, if you're playing, like, even just a two-color deck, it doesn't even always add what you want.
Nope. Certainly doesn't.
So, like, say, like, if you have, I don't know, like a red card, red-green deck, and you have a red card stuck in your hand. But you have no red mana, so you don't have any way to cast the red card in your hand, put it in your graveyard to add red mana.
Nope, just a whole lot. Just a whole lot of bad.
It's just bad. This is another one of those, like, really crappy rares that you could probably open.
Very true. Why? Could be very awful. And it's just like, why Wizards? What did we do to get so punished?
I feel like, I feel like they made this a rare just because it's like a quote-unquote mana rock. But yeah, it's like whatever. Literally the worst mana rock ever printed, probably.
Yeah, it's so bad. Oh, gosh, is it bad. So, as far as, you know, some of the multicolored cards, lands, I think that we did get a really good land in Westfall Abbey and some, you know, decent lands with Draenor Temple and, you know, the Shadowlands. And then some of the multicolor cards are very powerful. Some of them may not have homes exactly, or might be a little bit overrated right now. But definitely feel like, you know, the multicolor cards that we talked about are good. Yeah.
I think.
And then the one colorless card we talked about is garbage.
Yep. Yeah, that's garbage.
Sorry, guys.
The artifact colorless card.
Sorry, team. Everyone tried real hard.
No, they didn't try real hard. They tried real hard to make it bad.
Well, they corrupted it. They were successful.
That's true. I just want a Graph Stone then.
Yeah, a regular Graph Stone should be sweet.
Yeah.
It costs like one mana. It comes into play untapped. You search your library for a card to put into your graveyard, and then you can tap.
Oh, yeah, that's perfect.
You want one that doesn't have like ghosts coming out of it?
Yeah, no, exactly. No ghosts. Yeah. I'm not afraid of them, but I don't want them either.
Yeah, I'm not afraid of no ghosts either, but...
Correct.
I'd like to...
We did it.
You know.
All right.
Bust them.
Anyway, so that's our set review. Now let's move on here, pick up the pace. Let's talk about the top five cards that we feel will impact Standard, minus the Shadowlands. Obviously, those are going to be played and will impact Standard. But these are in no particular order. But we're going to start with a bit of a cheat. Sorry, guys. It's going to be Arlong Horde / Sorin, because we were kind of medium on both of them. But they're both the gold planeswalkers of the set, so... Meh. Definitely not Nahiri, though. Get wrecked, Nahiri.
Nahiri will still see play, but it just won't be like.
Yeah, it just, yeah.
It won't like. It like. If Nahiri wasn't in the format, you wouldn't really miss it.
Right.
I feel like that's how it's going to be. But right. It'll be okay.
Next up, Archangel Avacyn. Easy slam dunk pick of the century. Like, pff, yeah, the card's obviously going to be real good in the format.
She literally is on fire.
Yeah,
like she dunks the basketball, the hoop's on fire, she's just flying over people.
Yeah. Speaking of her flying over people, next card we have is Depends. Descend upon the simple.
Never mind, I was going to make a joke.
Yeah, don't make a poop joke.
I bet it was a poop joke.
Probably poop it was going to be a poop joke.
Anyway.
Flying over people. Yeah. Never mind.
Oh, we've been,
all right, that's
we've
it.
Been so doing this for too long. It was like a bird poop joke.
Kinda.
Are you gonna like poop on humans? It depends.
I mean, only if they're delirious. I guess.
Man, I think we're becoming a little bit delirious.
It's like eating Soren's tacos, man. I'll tell you, spicy.
Next up, we have Declaration of Stone. In Stone.
What is both of you putting
ups? In of? I don't know.
Propositions are
important. I never said thing of the ice.
I'm checking it.
I probably did.
Declaration in Stone. Definitely premium removal. Probably be the better than you think it is. Cast it. See if you like it. And then lastly, Westbell Abbey. Just a colorless land that people have access to. Certainly one of the best abbeys that I know of. And I don't know that many abbeys, though.
Abbey Normal?
Yeah.
This Dear Abbey?
Better than those.
Okay.
And we have some top cards from Modern as well.
Dave put these up here. We disagreed.
Yeah, so Dave can say them.
He's saying top cards from Modern. They're like, these are cards that could possibly see play in Modern.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not a lot. I think
the one that we
can agree upon is probably Invasive Surgery. Yeah.
Yeah. I think Thing of the Ice in sure. The Ice is I think it will see modern play. I just think it's too easy to turn on. And I think Traverse the Ulvenwald is possibly a player in modern just because it's much easier to turn on Delirium in that format. And I think it does something that we don't really have access to in that format. So
fair enough.
Cool.
That brings to an end our set review show. Congratulations, guys. We did it. So let's quickly wrap up here. So this weekend, obviously, are pre-releases. They're going to be happening at your local store. Comic Talon has five total events. Is it six or five?
They have midnight, three on Saturday, two singles, and a two at a giant, and then two on Sunday.
Gotcha. So six total events that you can play in over the weekend. You still have an option to even run the gauntlet if you really want to, but it has been told to us that these spots are filling up quickly. People are very excited to play with these cards, so if you want to participate, please get in contact with Comic Town. You can check out their events all at Comic Town on Comic Town Gaming Center's Facebook page. And you can just search for Comic Town Gaming Center on Facebook, like I told you in the beginning of the episode.
It's true. And I will say, like, I signed up for Saturday's event today, and I was one of the last people, I think, in the slot. That's a Saturday 10:30. So if you're trying to get in for any of these events, do not sit on your hands. They might grotesquely mutate.
Yeah, true. Yeah.
We didn't talk about that card, but it's in the set. Just throwing it out there.
Hungry hand.
Guy's hand gets all tentacly.
It's bad. We also have the Comic Town Spring Classic coming up. It's just over a week away. It's going to be the first week that Shadows of Innistrad is legal on April 9th. It'll be held at Comic Town. Registration will open up at 9, 10 a.m. start time, $30 entry fee, 2K in total prizes, and you can queue for the finals, the Comic Town Classic Series finals, which will be a 5K in December. That is an invitation-only tournament.
You know who's invited? This guy.
Mr. Dave is invited. Congratulations.
How are you invited?
I finished second at the
Winter Classic. Okay, I forgot I counted that one. I forgot. I was thinking like, because that was last year technically, so it was my bad, right? No, it was January, wasn't it?
It was January.
Yeah. Okay, never mind. Awesome. That's insane.
Yeah.
I think there's only about 32 people in that tournament, so that's a sweet series that Comic Town's going to do.
Yeah.
Yep, I'm pretty excited about it. Like, even if you go O and X, you still get $100.
Value.
So yeah, it's just pure value.
Awesome. And also, Comic Town's also going to be having a modern format Star City Games IQ on Sunday, April 10th. $30 entry fee, $9 a.m. registration, 10 a.m. start time. And this will be after the updated band restricted list comes out. So hopefully it will not be an Eldrazi invested format.
And we will have that to talk about next week.
Oh man, I'm very excited. So we'll, catch us next week to hear us talk about Modern a little bit and our pre-release experiences, because I know I'm going to be at the 10 a.m. pre-release, I believe.
I will be.
Dave is going to be as well, and you just said that you registered. It's going to be the 64-man capped, correct?
Right, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm actually pre-releasing.
Because that's how you get that box. We got to get that box so we can test.
Hashtag get the box for Mike.
So we can draft a debt Mike.
Yeah. So that's everything for us this week. Again, you can find us on Facebook at Your End Step. Just do a search for that. Or on Twitter. We're at symbol Your End Step. Also, we have a Gmail account. Gmail.com. At Your End Step at gmail.com.
We're very tired.
Mike distracted me and I got off my talk track here. But we hope you enjoyed this very long, very filled episode. We're gonna go to bed immediately after this.
Probably all my own.
We're gonna do a sleepover at Mike's. It'll be great. Have a good time. Anyway, we'll have a good one and we'll talk to you guys next week. You have a great one. Bye.